Welcome to another edition of the Word on Woodward. I'm Daniella Bruce alongside Art Regner, and joining us today, Red Wings goaltender Alex Nedeljkovic. Ned, thank you so much for taking the time to join us today. It's been a while and we're excited to catch up with you.
Yeah, absolutely. It's been a long summer and camp's right around the corner, so looking forward to seeing everybody back at the rink.
Before we get to the really important stuff, you had got the chance to do something really cool this summer, which is flying with the Blue Angels. And I have to ask you about that experience. Just tell us about it. And did you throw up or pass out up there? Because I am so curious.
Yeah, it was incredible. I didn't throw up. I didn't pass out. So I was pretty proud of myself for those two things. It's so tough to describe, just because it's really not like anything else. Like, if you're a roller coaster person, you really got to think of like the fastest roller coaster you've ever been on, and then like multiply it by like 50 at least. It, you know, there's, you can't replicate it. There's nothing else you can do to replicate it. So the fact that we were going so high, so fast, and doing all these flips and loops and, going upside down, like, I don't know. I feel like I might have lost the words. I feel like a little kid, like in a candy shop. Just, I don't have any words for it. I'm just so excited. I was so excited.
You know, I've always heard that when you're in something like that and you're going like the speed of sound or whatever, you're going so fast that you don't actually feel it. It's like you're not even moving because you can't comprehend how fast you're going. Is it true, or did you know, man, I'm really moving?
No, I felt like we were moving. Like, I couldn't really move in the seat, personally. Like, in the videos, I'm always, like, holding on to this, like, little strap or whatever, like, the seat belt, basically. Part of that was, like, a little bit of nerves. I was, like, trying not to fall out for whatever reason. But, the way that the Gs work, it's, like, every G is, like, I think, multiply your body weight by that number. So if you were like going 2 G's, you would multiply your body weight by 2, and that's how heavy you would feel. So I'm a 200-pound guy. We went 7.5 G's, so it felt like I had at least 1500 pounds weighing, like, holding me down in my seat. So I wasn't moving at all when we were going that fast. So it was just really cool, I'm very grateful that I had the opportunity to do it.
Well, let's get to talking a little bit of hockey, Alex. And we are going to talk about some of the new additions that Steve Yzerman made over this offseason. The one addition that is probably going to affect you the most is the trade for Ville Husso. They trade third round pick in the 2022 draft and end up with another goaltender. So just from your perspective, what do you know about Ville Husso, and how excited are you to kind of tag team this season together?
Ville and I have talked a handful of times here since the trade was announced. Other than the few times we've talked, I don't really know much about him. I'm looking forward to getting to meet him when he gets into town, and hopefully, stepping things off on the right foot. But everything I've heard from guys on the team, guys that have played with him, he's a really great guy, he's a great person. He always cherish playing with guys that are really good people, because it makes it that much more enjoyable to go into the rink and share your time with those kind of guys. And I think it'll be great for the both of us to have each other, to push each other to get better and be better every day, and try to help carry the team, back into the playoffs. Obviously, we brought in a lot of other guys this summer, and there's a lot of buzz, and definitely working out with the guys down at the rink, there's a lot of buzz and there's excitement that we're going to make that next step, or at least take another big step this year. And obviously the goal is to get back into the playoffs and compete for a Stanley Cup. So I think, I think Billy and I can definitely help push us towards that goal.
You're in competition with one another, yet you're the only two goalies on the team. So if you're going through something, the only guy that maybe understands what you're going through is your partner, who you're in competition with. How important is it that it's a friendly competition? Because I've seen, and I'm not going to name names, other pairings where the guys weren't exactly on the same page, shall we put it.
Yeah, it's huge. You need to have, I think, a certain level of, one, like understanding that, we're teammates and we're trying to accomplish the same thing. So, I'm going to push you to be better. And for me, I expect kind of, I'd hope for the same in return. Like, I'd want Billy to be pushing me to be better every single day. And that's the only way we both can get better, and that's the only way that we can have success in this scenario, is if we're both doing well, hopefully, you know, as a team, we're doing well. And that, I think that goes for everybody, you know, up and down the lineup, not just the two of us.
Ned, you talk about how important it is to have that relationship and how you have to push each other to be better when you're, you know, your goaltending partner, right? And you guys, it's kind of on you to do that. But what about learning from each other? I feel like you've been in a few different situations, whether it was here or in Carolina, where you had the chance to learn from other goaltenders. And I'm sure that you and Ville Husso will be doing the same thing. Can you just talk about the dynamic from that aspect?
Yeah, I think in today's game, there's so many different ways that you can play this position. There's not like a one way fits all kind of thing, or like a generic way. This is how you have to play in order to have success. You know, obviously there's extremes where guys are being so naturally gifted, or they've just played a certain way for their entire life, and that's all they know. And it's not you can't really teach it, but they're just that athletic that they can do it. But I think for the most part, you can look and take little things maybe from everybody. And I think the same thing, like we're at the point now in our careers where I don't think you can necessarily change something major about how we play our position, but maybe little things like how we stand, like how we go into a post, or how we read a play, or how maybe we're reacting to things, or something very small that could maybe give us an edge over what we're currently doing right now. Or maybe it's just something that'll help us be a little bit more efficient, or just seeing it from a different, someone else's point of view, that maybe you don't necessarily think that's how it should be done, but it gives you another view of how it could be done, right? So, you know, there's really no right or wrong answer to it. There's just different ways to stop the puck.
I looked at it in at least the first half of the season through the January 31st. There's five back-to-backs. There's many, like, three games and five nights. And, you know, the schedule still seems compacted, is my point. Today, in today's NHL, and I want to know if this is a fair statement or not, you almost need two goalies today, right? I mean, I know you want to play all 82, but it's physically, humanly, as gifted as you are, impossible. So how have you seen a evolution, as I said, of the goaltending position where in today's NHL, you need two guys to go, even though the hot hand will play, you know, if he's hot? We all understand how that works, but are you prepared to say, yeah, look, you know, in today's NHL, we have to share the crease?
Yeah, you make a good point with the scheduling and how compressed it is and how many times you play, like, back-to-back. And our position is so unique that it's not only very physically taxing, but sometimes it can be even a little bit more mentally taxing, having to really stay focused for the full 60 minutes. But like you said, it's kind of, you're transitioning now into this world where, you do need two guys that are very capable of playing, you know, but somewhere between 35 and potentially 50 games. You don't really see around the league anymore guys playing 60 to 70 games. You know, it's very, very rare. There's only at most a handful of guys that do, and it's probably not even like, I don't know. I would think maybe GMs or coaches wouldn't really want it, because maybe they would want to rest some guys more. Just seeing how the trend and things are going these days, and rest is a weapon nowadays. But it's hard to do, because it's hard to play at such a high level for that many nights in a row and that many games in a row. You know, if you think about it, right, you want to play, say, you know, you want to have 90% of your games be like grade A, like top notch, right? Well, that number, right, so out of 40 games, right, I don't know what that number is, I'm not that good at math, but, you know, if you play 40 games, right, and you have 35 really good games, and those five games that are kind of so-so, that's not five, those five games, you know, you would hope maybe the guys in front of you can help bail you out. Maybe they can put up four or five or six goals and kind of bail you out. Now bump it up 10 more games, right? That maybe that opens up, you add one more game and add another 10. So now two more games. And it's just, there's more room, you know, there's more room for error in there, right? So you definitely need two guys to stay fresh and to give every, I think to if one of us is starting to kind of maybe have a little bit of a slump, the other one maybe, you know, hopefully is playing well too. So that way, you know, it just gives the other guy a day or two extra to kind of reset and break out of that slump.
Alex, I mentioned that we were going to talk about the free agents, right? So we talked about Ville Husso coming over to Detroit, and there were many other free agent additions. And we've heard Steve Yzerman and new head coach Derek Lalonde talk a lot about how they want the team defense to improve heading into this season. And I'm sure from a goaltender's perspective, that's great for you to hear, right? Like you want your team to be playing a little bit better defensively in front of you. When you look at some of the additions, like an Andrew Kopp, a Ben Chiarot, David Perron, these guys are tough to play against. Ole Mata, too, back there on the blue line. How do you feel about some of these additions? And do you think you're trending in that right direction where things are going to get a little easier for you and a little better defensively for your team?
Yeah, that's a big part of it. And, you know, not to, you know, at the end of the day, it's our job as goalies to stop the puck. Some nights, you know, it's a little harder than others. We're seeing little different scenarios. And sometimes got the guys in front of us, you know, it's an off night. But that's still, there's, you know, it's no excuse for us not to bail them out, right? That's in our job description. So it's you know, hopefully this year, you know, we can be maybe a little bit more consistently all around, and I think that'll help both Billy and I be able to sustain a high level of play and give us an even better chance to succeed, even on nights that, you know, the guys in front of us maybe are having an off night, or, you know, maybe it's just kind of like those 2-1 games or those like really tight scoring games, we come out on the other side, as opposed to maybe last year. You know, there was a few close games there that we just kind of let slip away at the end, you know, for whatever reason. And, you know, hopefully maybe we'll be on the other side of a couple of those games a little bit more often this year. Just, you know, I think a fresh start for some guys in a new city and a new team. And you know, even for us, the guys that are coming back from last year, new voices behind the bench and new faces in the locker room, maybe hopefully can kind of get a little bit of a positive vibe and good energy in the room. And, you know, sometimes that's, you know, sometimes a couple changes here and there can help. And sometimes a lot of changes also can kind of be an eye opener. It's like, all right, you know, team means business, guys mean business. Like, you know, we got to kind of pick it up now.
You know, there's obviously going to be a different blue line. And we can talk about some of the better veterans, and we know Chiarot's going to, you know, plaster people against the boards, and it's, you know, it's going to be a different vibe, as you said. However, you've got Mo Sider, who's a very young guy. By all accounts, Simon Edvinson, who is now, when he was drafted, he was 6'4". He's now 6'6". He's about to play for Team Sweden in the World Junior tournament. So I'm sure he's up to about 6'9" by now. But he is a guy that I think, you know, people like me have already penciled in the starting lineup. Can you talk about, from your perspective, hey, I love the young people, and I love, you know, these guys are supreme hockey players, but how many 20-year-olds can a goalie's mental fortitude stand when you're sitting there going, ooh, come on, give me a 30-year-old guy. I mean, you know, give me a little more veteran presence. Do you think about that stuff?
Honestly, no. And, you know, I got to meet Simon this summer. He was here training after development camp, and, you know, he's big. I thought Mo was big when I met him last year, and now Simon kind of makes Mo look a little small in terms of height-wise. So you know, he's still only 20 years old. You know, he's got a little bit of physical maturing to do, but he's already a really big guy. But the thing is, like, just because you're 20 years old doesn't mean you can't play. Like, it doesn't matter if you're 18, 20, or you're 38. Like, if you can play, you can play. And I think Mo was a really great example of that last year. It was from the training camp to the last game of the season. Like, it was steady Eddie. And, you know, he played. And he played at a very high level from start to finish. And, you know, he was 20, 21 years old. Like, I'll never, like, there was, like, 40-second clip. We were in Philadelphia, and we were on the PK, and Mo killed about 40 seconds of it individually. And as a 20-year-old, like, a 20-year-old defenseman, let alone a forward, you know, like, he's got the puck on his stick for 35 of those 40 seconds, and he's, you know, playing and just kind of making guys look silly, and it's great to see. So, you know, you can do that at 20 years old if you have the confidence and you have the abilities and you're feeling it. By all means, go ahead. It doesn't matter. You know, you can do it. Like, as long as you do it consistently and you're smart about it. And Mo, I thought, did a really great job last year. So, you know, if Simon can do that this year, then, you know, great for him, great for me, great for everybody.
Yeah, I'm kind of curious. You know, there was a coaching change made, and Derek Lalonde has been a head coach, but not at the NHL level. And he brought in a new staff, and you have a new goaltending coach. And I'm kind of curious, have they reached out to you? Have you talked to Derek? Have you talked to Westland, to the coach? I mean, where does all that stand? Or are you in the front frame of mind right now? I'm just trying to get my body and my mind up to speed, so when training camp starts, I'm there.
Yeah, I've had a chance and opportunity to meet everybody in person, and I've heard great things about everybody. So I actually got to skate with Westy a couple times while he was in town. I think getting kind of the lay of the land and things like that. So he was coaching in Hershey for I think the last 7 years. So when I was in Charlotte, I played Hershey quite a bit. I think we played him 8 times during the year, so, and then a couple times in the playoffs as well. So he's seen, you know, quite a bit of me over the year. So it was nice that he was already kind of familiar with me, and but really easygoing. And I thought he, those few days, he had, you know, he had a good mindset about coming into things. And you know, like I said, I think I'm a pretty easygoing guy, so I can get along with almost anybody. But I think it'll be good. I think, you know, having some new faces come in, and it's an opportunity for the coaching staff as well, you know, to kind of get their foot in the door or show that, you know, they can do this at an NHL level, right? So I think everybody this year is going to have not a chip on their shoulder, but there's going to be a little bit of an edge to everybody to show that, you know, we're not in the basement anymore. This team isn't at the bottom of the league. We're pushing to be at the top now. So.
All right, Ned, last question for me. As we look forward to training camp, which is really just about a month away now, not too far away at this point, what have you been working on all summer? What are some of the main focuses for you and your goals heading into a new season?
Pretty much, you know, what I said at the end of the year, right? Like, I want to be more consistent, try to find ways to be more consistent. And, you know, I've been spending most of my time down at the rink doing, you know, working out with Rob and the guys down there, and trying to just get maybe a little bit more comfortable at the rink and at the, you know, being there. And obviously last year was a fresh start in a new place, but, you know, I'm kind of comfortable with what I think my routine is going to be this year. You know, I know my route to the rink, you know, I know where I'm going to be doing stuff and where things are, and it'll be a little bit easier there. And just kind of stepping away from the rink, resetting and understanding that, you know, a lot happens at the rink, a lot happens away from the rink. And, you know, if that's just life, it's not always good. You know, there's some bad mixed in there. There's some downtimes, but you can't mix those two things. And I thought I was kind of thinking that previously in my career that I was able to keep those two separated. This year, I allowed it to intertwine a little bit. And I think that kind of affected me, you know, on the ice. And that goes towards that consistency. If you're not fully 100% in the, you know, in the here and now when you're at the rink and you're thinking about something else away from it, it's hard to play at this level and hard to play at a high level when you've got 2-3 other things on your mind. So for me, it's been trying to understand, like, you know, when you're at the rink, we're at the rink, and, you know, just focus on what's going on at the rink. And when you leave it, doesn't matter if you had a good day, a bad day, the day's over, you know, go enjoy your life. You know, I've got Emma at home. I got 2 great dogs now. And, you know, there's a lot to be thankful for and to be happy about. So just, you know, I've been trying to work on the mental side of it a little bit more. Hopefully that'll help contribute to being a little bit more consistent, a little bit more successful.
You know, one thing that Red Wing fans admired about you, not only your talent in net, is the fact that you had flowing locks. You had a hair that, you know, just was endless. I'm curious now, if you were to take off your ball cap there, which I'm sure has a big block M on the front of it, would you, it's a little inside, but if you were to take it off, is your hair, or did you get your hair cut? And is that the only cut you're going to get? You're not going to cut it during the season?
Yeah. So I got a cut, and to answer your ball cap question, it's not a big, ugly yellow M. It's actually a gorgeous looking state of Ohio with the Ohio flag on there. But moving on from that.
I thought that flag is a pennant, isn't it? It's not even square. It's not even like a flag. It's a pennant.
It's still a great looking flag.
Moving on to
the other question that you had.
About your hair.
About my hair, about the important stuff. Yes, the important stuff right. That people want to know. Yeah, I don't know, you know, it was just time for a fresh start. It's just time for a fresh start. I need to tighten the straps up on my helmet, and that's about the only adjustment I've really needed to make. So I don't know. I like it, but I like the long hair too. I felt like the long hair made me look a little bit more rambunctious, a little bit more laid back. So now I feel like that it's cleaned up and it's short. I look maybe a little bit more mature. So I don't know. Okay.
Wait, did you and Tyler Bertuzzi plan this together? Because I saw that he cut his hair as well this summer. So did you guys talk about this before you made the decision, or was it completely separate?
No, it was separate. I had been thinking about cutting it off, honestly, before I saw him with his new hair. I had been thinking, and that's usually how it goes for me, is I think about doing it, and then I take like a couple weeks, and then I think about it again. And then it'd take another couple of weeks. And then by just kind of like one day, I'm like, all right, I'm just going to go get it cut. It was just time. It was getting long, really long up top. And the bottom half was kind of like, because I did a little bit of like a short on the bottom, long up top look at the start of last year. And it was starting to get to a very awkward length where even if I had a man bun in, the bottom half wasn't long enough to include in that bun. And it was just... but it wasn't short enough where it looked neat and professional. So not even professional, it just didn't look good at all. So it was time to for a fresh start.
Yeah, thank you. And we'll chat soon. Good luck the rest of the offseason. Looking forward to September. And of course, a big thank you to all of you for tuning in to another edition of the Word on Woodward. We'll see you next time.